morning, everyone. This is a thank you for Dr. Charles and of the team for giving me the opportunity to give a talk here. It's a good basic talk for spine surgeons. It's titled Radiology for Spinal Tumors, and I welcome you all to this talk. Basically, when you talk about spinal tumors, it's very important to get good imaging done, which I'm going to speak about. And a CAT scan and MRI are the basic requirements of any center or wherever you want to diagnose these tumors. CT is very good for evaluating the amount of osseous involvement and the degree of cancellous and cortical bone loss. It also evaluates the risk for vertebral for body collapse or the further collapse. MRI is probably the benchmark, the gold standard, which we use to evaluate the epithelial space as well as the soft tissue involvement of the neural structures. You can do radionuclear scans as well as PET scans, which you can use for surveillance and also picking up to small metastasis up to 2 millimeters or so. If you look at this chart, basically these are the various types of tumors which are and where they present and what is the common age of presentation. Osteodystroma is very common, which you see usually in the posterior elements, see in second, third decade. Then you have something like an osteochondroma, could be any pair, but mostly in the spinal process. You could see a chondrosarcoma, which is in the vertebral body, usually in the third or decade afterwards. You may see a patient like of a giant cell tumor. Happens mostly in the vertebral body in the third to fifth decade. So what I'm trying to say that all these tumors which are up in the spine, they occur at different sites in the spine, in the posterior elements or anterior elements of the body or in the neural arc, and they come at very different ages. So keeping in mind this, then only you can go and see and diagnose on the radiology. So if you see the tumors which I just spoke about, if you see the location that, you know, if they're in the anterior part of the body, if you just divide the body into two parts, and the anterior is the vertebral body, you most commonly see a malignant tumor. And that could be metastasis, it could be a myeloma, plasmacytoma, lymphoma, chordoma. Exceptions which are most common is the hemangioma or maybe even a giant cell tumor. If you see the posterior elements, which includes the neural arc as well as the posterior elements, the most common is osteodystroma. Here is also where you get the osteoblastomas and the chondromas. Exceptions which most commonly you might see is the chondrosarcoma. If you look at the sites, if it's a lot of sites involved, multiple sites in the thing, the first thing which would come to your mind is metastasis. Other is a myeloma or lymphoma, which are the other common ones. If it involves adjacent vertebral levels, so you have one spine involved, another one on top, one down, basically. Those are seen in osteosarcoma, chondrosarcoma, as well as myeloma and other tumors. If you see the classification, which is basically based on what type of tumor it is, you have osteogenic, chondrogenic, vascular, hematopoietic, and other causes. Osteogenic most common is the osteodystroma and the osteoblastoma, which becomes a sarcoma later on. Chondrogenic is the osteochondroma, which becomes a chondrosarcoma later on. Vascular, you have the hemangioma and the lymph involvements. Hematopoietic are the ones which are usually malignant. They are the plasmacytomas and the multiple myelomas. The notochord ones are the ones which are malignant, usually which are the chordomas or chordomas, which you see in the sacrum. Then you have a giant cell tumor, which is like a benign giant cell tumor, but could be also locally malignant. Ewing sarcomas are the benign tumors. Coming down to benign tumors, you can see that osteodystroma, more probably commonly see, patient complains of pain in the night, and most commonly it happens the posterior elements is most involved. You'll see a nidus formation like this, and CT is a very good modality to pick it up. On an MRI, you can see the nidus is hypo-intense on T1 weighted images and variable signal on T2 weighted images. And if you do contrast, there is enhancement of this. Coming to osteoblastoma, they count about 30 to 40% of all osteoblastomas are in the spine. They originate to the neural arc and often extend to the vertebral body. Can see these two images, one is the CT scan and the MRI. On the CT scan, you can see a well-lytic lesion in the posterior elements and around the transverse process, and there is a surrounding sclerosis. On the MRI, you can see the lesion is hypo-intense and has mixed signal on T2 weighted. You do variable matrix mineralization. This is important to note. Coming to an osteochondroma, this is mostly seen in the spinous process. And if you get an MRI done, which is on the right side here, you can see that the T2 hyperintensity beyond cortex is the part which represents the cartilage's cap. Coming to a chondroplastoma and a chondromyxoid fibroma, these are very rare, very few you see, but you do can see them. You can appreciate on the CT scan that it's an aggressive tumor and expansive lesion, but it also has a sclerotic border. On an MRI, you can see that it's hypertensity within the matrix, and which represents the immature chondrite. It's hypercellularity, immersion, and calcification on histological analysis. So you can see that it involves the lumbar spine as well as the cervical spine. Hemangiomas may be benign, which is the most common one, but it also can be aggressive, which are very vascular. So on a CT scan, you'll see a polka dot and chondroid appearance. An MRI demonstrates T1 and T2 hyperintensity, which is interspersed with thick, low signal intensity vertical bone struts. You can see this one image of a CT scan, an X-ray, an MRI, as well as a DSA. What a DSA shows, that's a very vascular tumor. Giant cell tumor is also very, very common, and primary site is the vertical body. Upper sacrum will be the most common. These lesions are well-defined lytic, but without any matrix calcification or sclerotic rim. So you can appreciate here that there's areas of hypertensity inside the sacral tumor, and has lots of dense collagen and hemosiderin. On the right side, you can see that the total collapse of the C7 has happened. And even right to that is the, you can see that the C7 vertical body has collapsed, and that has gone into the compressing the thecal sac. Osteosarcomas, these basically are very aggressive tumors. They usually happen in the posterior elements, but can happen anywhere in the body, anywhere in the vertical body as well as behind. The telangiectatic osteosarcoma presents lytic lesion, and on MRI, fluid levels can be appreciated. Coming to a chondrosarcoma, this is basically also aggressive, and imaging in this shows a lytic destruction with chondroid matrix. It may look like a ring and arc in some cases. It usually arises from the posterior element. And on an MRI, you can see that it's contrasting on MRI on top, which shows that there's lobar enhancing mark, which may be arising from the right of the lamina. It compresses and displaces the cord. It's an aggressive tumor. There's another photograph. This is the CCT of an axial view of sacrum with a chondrosarcoma. And this is the chondrosarcoma of the left transverse process of L4. Another one is the hemangioendothelioma and hemangiopericytoma. I'll show you that these are also aggressive tumors. And you can see that this imaging reveals lytic lesion with honeycomb experience. So just to go through these four images, the one on the left is an X-ray, which will involve the pedicle. And then you have a contrast on CT scan, which shows involvement of the vertebral body. Then you have another image, which shows the MRIs. This shows intense enhancements of lesion. And it is a multiple curvilinear flow, which are characteristics of hemangiopericytoma. Lymphomas, they account for about 1 to 3% of lymphomas. Usually happen in the older generation. These lesions are lytic, mixed, and rarely sclerotic. So basically, you see them lytic, which is the most common. And in this MRI, you'll see a focus of marrow replacement and a large surrounding soft tissue without large area of cortical destruction. These are highly suggestive of lymphomas. Leukemia cases also seen. Commonly, you can see them, but mostly occur in children and mostly male children. So you can see that it involves the vertebral body as well as the neural arc area. And the diffuse enhancements seen on the contrast administration. These lesions appear hyperintense on T1 and hyperintense on T2. Chordomas is the second most common tumor. It happens in the sacral coccygeal area. Probably everyone's already seen these. So this typical appearance is of a mushroom collar button. You can see this is what it looks like. Okay. Ewing sarcoma is also seen. It is mostly seen in the sacrum. And it's an aggressive lytic lesion, like as happens in the femur anywhere. So here also is aggressive lytic lesion destruction, and there's collapse of the vertebral body. PNET is very rarely seen, but it can be seen mostly in the lumbar area. And I mean, they can you can see them, and if you follow them up to a month or 2 months, you can see that it eats up the whole body as well as the vertebral arch. Leiomyoma or leiomyosoma and the spindle tumor, these have to be kept in mind. These are permeative lesions with the indistinct outline, and they are better demonstrated in CT more than MRI. Intramedullary tumor is also very important because these also we see a lot. Most common one is ependymoma, then is the astrocytoma. The general characteristics of these are they cause spinal cord expansion, they produce high signal intensity on T2 weighted images, and the majority show at least some contrast enhancement. So just spend a minute on this, that you can see that like an example of ependoma, it is usually seen in the cervical cord. On T1, it's isotense to hypotense. On T2, it's hyperintense. Strong enhancement on contrast, and it shows in the cervical area. Second most common is the astrocytoma. You'll see in the thoracic cord, it's again isotense to hyperintense. And on T2, it's hyperintense. Maybe variable patchy on enhancement. So if you just see on this, everything is same here, except that on enhancement, the astrocytomas are variable and patchy. Other tumors like you might see a schwannoma, also seen in cervical cord. Similar parents, isotense to hypotense on T1 and hyperintense on T2. It may be heterogeneous on enhancement. But you see here like a dumbbell shape, I'll show you. Ependoma, this is what a characteristic looks like. And the T2 weighted images demonstrate a heterogeneous mass located centrally, displacing the normal cord laterally. Astrocytoma is the second most common tumor, and it happens in the thoracic cord, not in the cervical cord. And they also cause long masses, which are seen. And if you do contrast it with the condylomium, it demonstrates an undefined heterogeneous enhancing mass. You see the white arrows. Other rare ones which you see are hemangioblastoma, one of the A on top. The second is the ganglioma, intramedullary metastasis you can see in the C part, and the D is the primary intramedullary lymphoma. So these are different tumors which you can see, intramedullary type also. Schwannoma is characteristic, and you can see that it shows a dumbbell-shaped mass. You can see the black arrows coming out of the root area and passes out of the neural arc. So this is a characteristic of a schwannoma. Meningioma, these are basically isotense to the spinal cord. So you can see a big one head on the T1 image and hypertense on the T2 image. So the basic take-home message which you have to understand is that the plasmocytomas and multiple myelomas are the most common malignant primary spine tumors. Hemangioma is the most common benign tumor. Imaging is very important. You have to get an X-ray, a TCCT scan, an MRI, and if possible, a PET scan. Bone scans are also invaluable. All these will have involvement of the body, the soft tissue. It can cause infiltration of the marrow as well as an intraspinal extension. But you have to remember that all these tumors, you have to correlate with the age, when it appears, the sex of the patient, location, if it's happening anteriorly or in the posterior elements, it's happening in the cervical spine and the thoracic spine, wherever it's happening. And keeping all these in mind will give you maybe not a definite, but a close diagnosis of what kind of tumor it is. Thank you so much for